song to come on, you know.
Yeah, it was stage fright.
I heard you said Tiny Tim.
Oh yeah.
You gotta get out there.
We're making a lot of money, and he's there, and he goes, oh, I can't go on, Fred, I can't go on. So I said, listen, Tiny, if you don't go on, I don't get paid. I said, so you'll
go on.
You're
going on by the drink. You know? All right, nice story, Fred.
Yeah, Tiny Tim. The 100th show.
100th show?
Tiny Tim.
Right.
Rob Blair, he was a great guy, Tiny Tim, by the way. Awesome. Even though he was a crazy looking guy.
He tiptoed.
Yeah.
Now he's tiptoeing, pushing up babies.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, Raquel, our next comedian.
Yes, hello, welcome.
Hi, how are you doing today?
Great, please tell us your name.
My name is Tony Blatta.
Nice to meet you. Wow, where are you from?
I'm from the greatest borough in New York City. I'm from the Bronx.
Oh,
Bronx! Yeah!
Bronx! Wow, I should call this
Bronx
the Bronx
Bombers.
Show, right?
Bronx Bombers.
I want to thank Nevin and his crew for sending me on a first-class trip over here. I took a yacht. I appreciate it. It's called the Staten Island Ferry, so thank you for having me traveling there. Beautiful.
Staten Island Ferry.
Anything for the comedians, we send out the best.
Thank you.
Okay. How long have you been doing comedy?
I've been doing comedy for a little under 2 years now.
Oh, okay. How's it going?
It's going. I'm here.
Okay.
I'm on TV, Mom.
TV.
Do you have a favorite joke?
I'm still finding my groove, so I do not have a favorite joke now.
Okay. And have you ever written jokes about like a significant other?
Yes, I have.
And did they hear your joke?
Yes, they have.
What happened? Did you get in trouble?
No, you changed the names in the stories. You know?
Okay.
And then you get in trouble for that, too.
Oh, yeah, I'm sure. Do you have any dark secrets?
No, I do not have any dark secrets.
Not that you'll tell us.
No, I will not tell you.
All right. Hey, what made you get into comedy?
So I just like a lot of comedians, we have a past that had some impact on us, and we have a story to tell. We want to share some of our inner secrets and bring comedy joy to the audience and help them laugh. So that's why I decided to try comedy.
Okay.
Awesome.
Were you ever a class clown?
No, I was not. I was a serious dude in school.
Okay.
So.
Where can we find you?
You can find me on Instagram. My handle is Mr. Tony Blue Plata.
Awesome. You got 5 minutes?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you for that great intro. Give it up for yourself, audience members. Yeah. Yes, thank you for being here. All the great comedians before me, great job. My name is Tony, and I'm from the Bronx. I love being from the Bronx. People from the Bronx have a certain toughness to them that you can't find in any other borough. Just this morning, I was at McDonald's having breakfast, and this five-year-old was just like looking at me really mean. We call it mean mugging, you know, like, ooh, and he was just like flinching at me. And he's asking me questions like, in the Bronx, we use terms like yo. So he's like, yo, do I know you? Can I help you? And I said, yeah, you can help me. I'm your father. That's you know who I am. But the best thing about the Bronx is the women. Any women from the Bronx, clap it up. Bronx. Yes, Bronx women. I love women from the Bronx. They know what they want, and they tell you exactly what they want as well. Again, women from the Bronx start off sentences with the word yo all the time. And you're like, yo, I don't want you for my man. I want you for something more. And if they really like you, they throw the word son in. Yo, son, I want you in my life forever. And that's why I want you to be my first baby daddy. So, yeah, that's Bronx women for you. Bronx women, yeah. I was raised by a single mom. Any single moms in the audience? Of course not. I'm sure there's a lot of single moms at home. It was rough. It was rough for us. My mom raised 3 boys on her own in the Bronx. And she did a really good job. Only 2 of us have records, so good job, Mom. 2 of us have criminal records. But my mom wanted to make sure me and my brothers were following the right path, so she decided to send all three of us to Catholic school. Yeah. Education was so important to her and our safety, she decided to send us to Catholic. She was willing to pay for our education. And when you go to Catholic school, you get in trouble, you get something called detention. But in Catholic school, they don't call it detention. They call it JUG. J-U-G, JUG. Justice under God. Yeah, justice under God. That's what they call that. Any military service members here? No military service members. Okay. I'm actually a veteran myself. I served for over 20 years. Thank you very much. I do suffer from PTSD. For those who don't know that, it's called post-traumatic stress disorder. But it's actually not for my time at war. It's for my time going to family court for all the child support hearings I have to go to. I have children. Children are a blessing. I thought children were such a blessing that I decided to have several children. And unfortunately, all my children were born with AMD. It's a rare genetic condition found in Puerto Rican men. It's only found in me. All my children were born with AMD. They were all born with all different mothers. Yes. That's what they were born with. That's that. But dating back in the day when I grew up, it was just different. The only thing you needed to know was someone's zodiac sign, you know? Like, hey, what sign are you? Oh, I'm a Virgo. I'm like, yeah, I'm okay. My ex was a Virgo. Hey, what sign are you? Oh, I'm a Cancer. Yeah, the sign says it all. You know, I'm good. But these days, when you date someone, you have to know their love language. You guys know anybody's love language?
No.
No. It's crazy. Like, you go on a date, you're like, hey, what's your love language? Oh, I'm physical touch. Hey, what's your love language? Oh, I'm quality time. And you're like, I really don't care what your love language is. But in the Bronx, we have our own version of those love languages. Like for people in the Bronx, quality time, we call it Netflix and chill. So that's a love language we created in the Bronx, yeah. Yeah, so again, thank you for being here. You guys are a great audience. I want to congratulate Nevin and everyone here in the Staten Island Comedy Show for having 100 years of, 100
years.
Shows.
100 years could really be you, trouble.
Yeah. Thank you for inviting us as well. But that's all I have. That's my time, Nevin. I appreciate you.
Whatever. whatever.
What song you want?
Technical difficulty, but we have a special
guest. Oh, you got Saki.
Show, it's Saki.
But you'll be on Faker News. You do the weather once in a while, right?
Yeah. So, okay. So, if they have the, well, I guess they don't have the show. I'm going to introduce the next guest. And the next guest is Debbie Barza.
Hi, Debbie.
You gotta watch him. He's a dirty sock. You know, I lost his brother in the dryer.
Oh. Yeah.
So, Debbie, where are you from?
I'm from the Bronx.
Oh, okay.
Yes. All right, cool. I came in with the bus.
You came on the yacht.
Yes. We stopped. Yeah. Where do you think we get here? We had to take a bus, a train, wow. A ferry. Yeah, wow. It was some trip.
Awesome.
Yes.
Yeah, lucky you didn't get pushed in front of the train like everybody else down there. But anyway.
This is a happy yet sad. You're talking about being people get pushed into the train. I don't know.
That's New York. Anyway, how long have you been doing comedy?
About 10, 12 years, but there were a few breaks.
Oh, yeah? Oh, okay.
Yeah, my husband died. Yeah, my late husband, yeah.
Oh, wow. Sorry to hear that.
Yeah, it took time for another husband to get back to comedy, yeah.
Right.
I get the bills paid. I had teenagers.
I know, this show is getting depressed. They said I was 100 years old. This was the 100th year show. Some people say I don't look anywhere over 99.
I'd say that tie's beautiful.
Oh, thank you.
That shirt,
thank you.
Yeah.
So purple.
Yeah. You picked it out yourself or your wife laid it out for you?
Yeah, you know. Yeah. You know that works.
Yeah.
Okay. Who's your favorite comedian?
Well, if I didn't send my daughter Adrienne Appalucci, I wouldn't be able to see her from forgetful.
Oh, that's
yeah,
awesome.
Yeah, no, seriously. I like Kevin Hart, too.
Oh,
I like comics that talk about life.
Right. He got slapped in the face, didn't he?
No.
That was Rock. That was Chris Rock.
Yeah, Chris Rock.
The award show.
I know. I'm sure we're having all this.
All this depressing stuff.
Throw me up there. Let's get the audience real low. How low can we go?
Do you hate when anyone on the street comes up to you and asks you to tell a joke?
I do.
What do you tell them?
I don't know. What do I tell them? I tell them to come to a show. I tell them if I was a gynecologist, would you tell me? Would you lay on the table? I don't know.
Okay.
You could tell these were not planned questions.
What do you believe set you apart from other comedians?
I think my life.
Oh,
yeah,
cool.
My life experiences.
Yes.
I've been married 3 times.
Right.
Yeah, looking for a fourth husband. Yeah, not everyone's doing that kind of material.
Here we go, getting depressed again.
No, seriously, I wouldn't get married again. I'm not giving up my ex-husband's social security.
What's your favorite TV show?
Oh, the Staten Island cable show.
Yay!
And the Tonight Show. No, Jimmy Fallon.
Jimmy Fallon, okay.
Yes.
You were on Jimmy Fallon.
I was. That was like my friend Bruce Lipsky says, even a blind squirrel gets a nut now and then. That was a great experience.
Awesome. Yes. You got your 15 minutes of fame.
Well, it's a little less than 15 minutes, but I'll take it.
Okay. Okay, awesome. Do you have first?
Yes.
I always forget this. Everybody forgets this. Where can we find you? On Facebook and stuff?
Yeah, I'm on Facebook, Instagram, Debbie Barza.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, it's very simple.
Right, you have a 5-minute set for us?
I do.
Okay. Debbie Barza, ladies and gentlemen.
show. I'm so glad I could be here. Wow. I was here many years ago with my ex-husband. And now I remember why we didn't come back. It's a long trip. It really is. But I have to say, I've been married 30 years. Thank you. Thank you. It took 30 husbands. It took three husbands, but it's still 30 years. Yes. My ex was, you know, he wasn't very good with foreplay, you know? For him, foreplay was, take a shower, I'll be up soon. I mean, come on, middle of the night, Deb, you up? I mean, come on, that's not to me foreplay, right? We fought all the time we fought. We're actually divorced Bronx style, we're still living in the same house. And I got to tell you, everything I do bothers him. He came up the other day, he said, you're the worst housekeeper I ever saw. I said, it took you 20 years to figure this out. You never noticed when we were getting laid. You know what I mean? All of a sudden now, he can see and he has eyes, right? He can hear. He criticizes the shows I like. I like Lifetime movies where women get young, good-looking men to get young. This is hard up here. Young, good-looking men to kill their husbands. I find that entertaining. One day, I was watching Women Who Kill, and he came up. And he says, are you getting ideas how to kill me? I said, no, they show you what not to do, too. So I am dating. I am dating. And it's not easy when you're living with your husband trying to date. A lot of the men want to know, where do you live? Where do you live? Don't worry, you're not coming over. And the men got so cheap. First guy out wanted to take me to the park in his neighborhood. I said, I have my own park across the street. I'm not traveling to you. I mean, come on. Next guy, my very first date, we go to McDonald's for a coffee date. And I don't mind, McDonald's coffee's good if it's fresh. What bothered me was before COVID, when the guy pumped his chest out and he said, get whatever size you want. Like I didn't know it was a dollar all day long. Then he pulls out two coupons from his pocket, these crumpled old coupons. He said, you want to share a French fry or an apple turnover? I said, I ate already. I didn't want to break his heart. Those coupons looked older than us. I mean, come on. Too much. I was dating a retired dentist with a boat. I know, Nevin, you want to take me on the boat. It's almost like a boat with witnesses and a crew. I'm not getting on a boat alone with you. You remember what happened years ago? An actress, a very famous actress? She was on with her husband and two other people. She fell off the boat. Nobody even knew. Now, I can understand if you got a big party, you know, like 50, 60 people. There were four people on this boat. A quarter of your people are missing, and you don't notice? I mean, you know, get me on a boat. Then I went out with a guy who was a gambler. But he would get lost for the holidays. New Year's Eve, Valentine's Day. All of a sudden, I heard from him in October. And I remembered, my birthday's in September. That's why he's looking. Oh, this isn't... So I'm dating another man. I told my friend, I said, he has a sniffling problem. He's like, sniffles. So are you picking on him? I said, if I was picking, I'd say something about his penny loafers. Who wears penny loafers in this day and age? They got old. He said, he's got a new pair of shoes. I was so excited. You know what he got? Another pair of penny loafers. I don't know. Not easy out here. But I would never get married again. I'm not giving up my ex-husband's social security. That's not happening. I'd have to work another 7 years to make $400 a month. Come on. You can't make this stuff up. Yeah, so I do have a daughter who's doing comedy. She's doing very well. Yeah, very good. I said, so maybe we could do a show together. She goes, oh, no, Mom, I want separation. Separation? You're living with me. What kind of separation is that? You know another thing that used to bother my ex? He used to say I fuss more for the GYN than him. I don't know, ladies. Am I the only one I shave as high as I have to? Raquel, tell me, right?
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Capris, skirt, GYN.
Oh, yeah.
He'd say, you fuss more for the GYN than me. I said, that's because you don't have me in stirrups with a strobe light on me. Always picking, always fighting. Always finding something to pick about. We were widowed a few months apart. It started out beautiful. He would take me out for dinner. He'd talk about his late wife. I'd talk about my late husband. It was like we were on a double date. Having the time of my life. I was going out, bringing home leftovers. few weeks into it, say, is this going to lead to anything? Because if it's not, I don't want to waste my time. So we did get married. We had a big fight on a honeymoon cruise. Why wait? And I woke up, he was missing. I panicked. You can't have two husbands die right after the other. That don't look good. You're like coming after me. I was so glad when I saw him in the distance. I realized, who could believe you get a big fight over the railing anyway? So, yeah. He was a nice guy, though. He was very smart. He told me so all the time. He told me how smart he was. Yeah, my pickings weren't the best. People ask, how'd you get married three times? Eh, I settled. You're laughing. I did. First was a drug addict, right out of rehab. Love of my life, I gotta say, love of my life. We did everything together. Laundry, food shopping, welfare, always with me. What a guy. And he was a homebody. He'd look so cute in front of the TV, he'd be like this. You know, one time he fell asleep while I was talking to him. I got insulted. And then I found out he went back on heroin, so I felt better it wasn't me. My second was a degenerate gambler. Loved to go away every summer. We had to go on vacation to his aunt's house, Crescent, Pennsylvania. The only thing to do out there was bingo, binge, and church. On the way home, we had to stop at Atlantic City. Do you know, we had to wait until he made enough, or he gambled long enough to get a few food vouchers, right? One day we're online, he hears this other degenerate say, I got an extra food voucher if somebody wants to sit with me. You know, he pushed me to sit with this stranger just to save a few dollars. I felt like he was pimping me off. I mean, come on. Why didn't he sit with the guy? Guys say gambling is an invisible disease. You don't notice it unless you look at how they dress. That's a scruffy look. I'm telling you, and their pants, usually their behinds are down to the knees because those are lucky pants. They ain't changing those pants. They're winning in those pants. Those pants are not getting changed. Well, this has been a lot of fun. I thank you so much. Congratulations on the 100th show. And now we're going to get back to Nevin. Nevin, thank you.
Hallelujah.
I almost got up there and danced myself with a sock. With a sock.
Nevin, you can't take Nevin out of the kitchen. Wait a minute.
So our next guest.
Yes. Hello, how are you today?
Raquel, I'm dying. How are you?
Tom Panabano.
Tom, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
So Tom, he's been on the show a lot.
Oh, okay.
And he provided some of the jokes, or most of the jokes, of all of the jokes for the Faker News.
Wow!
Tom is a writer, a joke writer. He wrote jokes for Rodney Dangerfield, amongst others.
Right.
And awesome.
No respect.
Appreciate you giving me the chance to write them for you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. And Kevin Kumquat thanks you also.
Fine. And I thank him for wearing that toupee. Wonderful.
Okay. So Tom, you're from Queens, right?
Yeah.
And this is the 100th show. You've been on quite a few shows. And
yeah, I think 85.
Right. And you are a regular on the Staten Island Comedy Show.
Yes. So
about 85 shows.
That's a bit of an exaggeration, yeah. But yeah, it's a lot. It's a lot.
So, do you have a question for
them? I do have a question. When you write the joke, do you tell people how they should say it?
Not basically, because when I've written jokes for people, they're kind of advanced in the comedy world, so they know how to deliver it, you know.
Okay.
If I'm working with a newcomer, I might tell them how to emphasize certain words, maybe do an act out while they do the joke. Okay. But with the people that have been established, they know how to do it.
Okay, very cool. Are all of your jokes based on personal experience?
No, well, my jokes might be. When I write for somebody else, it has to be in their voice, what they talk about, their background. So you have to kind of put yourself aside and put yourself in their world.
Okay, how long do you study that person?
Oh, I'll do as much as I can. I'll try to go see them in person or look at them on YouTube, whatever I can do to study them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Are you single?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Are you looking?
Oh, yes, always.
Very good. Well, I know there's someone
looking.
Else here that was also looking.
All right.
That's very cool.
So do you have an example of one of your jokes you did for Rodney Dangerfield?
One of the jokes.
The bowling?
Rodney Dangerfield. Oh, my father got me a job in a bowling alley as a pin.
That's great.
That's a Rodney joke. Yes.
Awesome. So what do you see for yourself in 5 years, besides the Staten Island Comedy Show?
Besides, probably still writing, still performing, and I'll hopefully write more jokes for you, and you'll be delivering it on a 200th show.
Right, and you also were part of the Faker News. You were the sportscaster on a few of the virtual shows.
That was
and,
fun.
A lot of people loved you, and we look forward to more sports casting jokes.
Oh, I'd love to do that.
On the virtual show. And here on the Staten Island Comedy Show, as you can see, Kevin Cumquat just came.
I know. Maybe you could buy a new toupee with that money.
Yeah. Awesome.
Yes.
Awesome. So, do you have any advice for any up-and-coming comedians that are aspiring to be a comic?
Basically, get as much stage time as you can. Try out new material. Try at least one new joke every time you get up there. Because it's basically eliminating what doesn't work. And then you try something new. Well, that works. You add it to your routine. And now, all of a sudden, you got more time.
Right.
Yeah.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. Now, where can we find you?
Well, my name, Tom Panabano, on Facebook, Instagram, I'm Tom Comedy 2, the number 2. My website, tomcomedy.com.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So, you have a set for us tonight? I do. All right. Tom,
All right. New York's a crazy town, isn't it? Really, I mean, on the subways, there's now a shortage of subway conductors. So I asked my Uncle Dulio if he's coming out of retirement to be a conductor again. And he said, 42nd Street, I guess that means yes. Now, there's a lot of rude people on the subway. I'm not rude. This man said to me, "You know what train goes to Coney Island?" I said, "Yes, I do. Have a nice day." I nice to me, you know. Now, my apartment is practically as bad as the subway. Has bugs. And the other day, I ran out of Raid. So I sprayed a cockroach with lemon pledge. Yeah, it died, but had a great shiny finish. Exciting for me, yeah. You know what's finished? My love life. My girlfriend and I broke up. I remember saying to her, honey, while we were dating, were you dating other men? She goes, oh, Tom, come on. You're the fifth guy to ask me that today. Terrible. And I'm not good at meeting women. I went to this club. Hey, babe, what's your sign? Keep off. So I was talking to this one woman. She said she wants to date 10 men at the same time. I said, I'm not into that. I'm monotonous. Told her. Oh, this other woman said she wants to date a man comfortable in his own skin. I said, forget about me. I have psoriasis. And then she was itching to leave.